self-confidence was back like that. The minute that Ray rang the bell and closed us out, I was like, wow, all right.
Hey, what's up? I'm Steve Eckert, United States Marine entrepreneur and instructor of the project. Welcome to another episode of the MDK Project Show. That's the Modern Day Night Project Show. This is a show for men in search of meaningful transformations in their family, fitness, finances, and faith to discover true fulfillment in their lives through physical, mental, emotional hardship and sacrifice so they can become even better husbands, fathers, leaders, entrepreneurs, and men. I have a special guest here today, a graduate of class 006, Chris Barth. What's up, freak? Welcome to the show. Just introduce the watcher, the viewers to yourself. Where are you from? What do you do?
Absolutely. My name's Chris Barth. I am from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and I own an Anytime Fitness in a town called Muskego, about 45 minutes southwest of Milwaukee.
I always wonder where the fuck that was. I always see the city. I'm like, I don't know. I thought that was
the hell is that?
I thought it was in like Canada or something like that. I had no clue where the fuck that was.
Might as well be.
Learn something new every day. So thanks, Ken, for coming on the show, and appreciate taking the time out of your life to come for another week to come over here. You know, especially in the fitness industry, it's tough to get away, I'm sure. So you're here to help out this class coming up as a junior instructor, and you know that we appreciate you coming out here for that.
Thanks a lot. It's exciting to be here.
Good stuff. So let's jump right into it. Let's jump into your class. How long has it been since you graduated now? Not too long.
5 months. I graduated in November.
Okay, got it. So you were class 006. When you first signed up for the project, what was it that first spoke to you or resonated with you? What were some things you were going through or you were looking to achieve out of it? Like, why'd you even sign up for the project in the first place?
Yeah, so I actually signed up a year before I actually committed to it. So I had started watching Bedros on Instagram.
You were waiting to get the senior citizen discount.
I was.
After your birthday clicked, you got the senior citizen discount.
I did, yeah. I showed my AARP card and you guys were like, cool, we'll give you that break. So I saw it and I talked with Aaron. I was going through a really rocky time in my marriage at the time and thought I needed to get that self-confidence back and just take that next step. And it spoke to me. And then I hesitated at the price, and I knew I wasn't going to be supported at home, so I waited on it, and I kept seeing what was going on, and then after I got through the coronavirus and the business was still around, I thought, you know what? I got to do this. I don't care if she supports me or not. I got to do this. So, and she didn't, because now we're going through a divorce, but that's okay, because I had to edit that relationship. So it was about finding my self-confidence. It was about leveling up in every which way, all the four F-bombs, the fitness, the finance, the faith, and then getting the fulfillment as well, making sure that I could live the best life I possibly could.
Got it. So at first you didn't have the support of your then wife, is what you're saying, and
correct.
Then now that is no longer
correct.
The situation.
Correct.
So the project will help you trim the fat in your life. That's all. We don't even need to talk about anything else. We will hook. No, seriously though, it will help you one way or the other.
Right.
If it's something you want to fix and work on and commit to and work towards, if you were struggling, you it's going to help you choose that trajectory you're going in your life. And
absolutely,
it seems like that's part of what the process was. So that's awesome. What were some of your fear? It took you a while. You said when you signed up before you actually came in. What were some of the fears or doubts that you were having leading up to the start of your class?
Yeah.
Other than being old as fuck, like literally, he showed up with like he had like a little baggie, like a little coin thing that opened up. He had like coupons and shit, trying to get like discounts on stuff.
Yeah, didn't work. Well, I'm 52. Since you keep mentioning that, so yeah, thank you.
Fucking savage,
right?
Savage. Holy shit.
So I was afraid of, I thought about how many young people are getting into this, but I thought, fuck it, I can still do this. I still work out like a maniac. So I wanted to do it. I was most afraid of the ice bath because I don't like cold. Even though I live in Wisconsin, I don't like the cold. And then I was also a little bit nervous of the surf torture because I saw some of the sizzle reels. I'm like, wow, that's...
Don't call it surf torture. You're going to scare the people away. We just go to the beach. We hang out.
I was worried about if I could build a sandcastle and how I would be able
sunburn.
To backstroke.
We might not have had enough sunblock.
Right.
We only had SPF 50. His pale white skin and SPF 75. That was his only concern.
That was my concern. Yeah. So it was that. And just, can I make it through? Because it's 75 hours of just getting kicked in the balls is a long time. So that were my fears. But
so you had some self-doubts in yourself. Where did that, where else was that kind of popping up in your life? Your doubts about yourself, whether or not you have what it takes, what are you really made of? Was that something that was going on for a while?
Yeah, I mean, I had been bullied as a kid from my father to people in school, because I, you know, just about an inch taller than a Keebler elf, so that doesn't help. And so I always had that. And then when the marriage was going south, she was starting to bully me on things, telling me I wasn't worth it, I wasn't good, I wasn't this, I wasn't that. So you start hearing that enough and you have nowhere to turn, you start to think about that. But then when I decided I'm doing this project because this is not me, I need to get my swagger back.
So you're like a gangster. Get your swagger back. You look like the hip hop type, right?
Yeah, that's me. No.
Rock and roll. You used to be a break dancer. See you break dancing. You must got some funky ass moves in the dance floor.
Maybe. Maybe. I'll show you later.
As white as can be. Anyway, let's keep it rolling. So you had some hesitations. Obviously, everyone does.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
Shit, I watch the videos. I'm like, I'd be scared to fucking do that. Some of that stuff. I mean, it's cool stuff, but she had some hesitations. You got over it. You show up. Tell me, what were some of your, once we're actually in the program, what were some of your least favorite memories, experiences, evolutions, tasks that you had to do other than losing your fucking book? You still don't have your book, do you? You still don't know where it is, do you? You lost your battle book like 17 times during 75 hours.
I did, but the reason, and here's the reason why, and I told you this the other day.
You had your reading glasses on.
I didn't have those. I didn't have my cane or my walker, so it really sucked. And the ones that I didn't like the most was the pit. The pit sucked. But then, like halfway through, I was like, wow, the pit is actually about life. The pit is, you're crawling through and you got some nice soft dirt and maybe a little bush there, and that's fine. And the next thing you know, you got a thicket sticking you in the dick and you're crawling across asphalt and glass and you're getting
a thicket sticking you in the dick. I love it. We're going to fucking trademark that shit. That's going to be our next ad. Thicket, I don't even know what a thicket is. A thicket sticking in a dick, which just sounds
something
cool as
hell. Stabby. I didn't know what the hell it was, but that kind of sucked and that was hard. The next one was, I don't even know what the hell the evolution's called. This sucks, maybe, where we're carrying.
This sucks.
Yeah, we're carrying logs. We're carrying this little thing called the twig and backpacks. And I remember walking through this and I'm taking four steps. I'm like, this is bullshit. Why am I doing this? This is ridiculous. I'm tired. And then the next thing I know, Ed, who does all the videos for us, he snaps a picture of me and I hear it and I go, well, shit, that'll never make it. So I got to stick around now. And then the other one was we had just finished pulling the truck.
Hold on. Before you even got to the next one, don't lose your train of thought. So you only didn't quit because they took a picture of you and you wanted to make sure you got to see the picture. So it wouldn't get deleted because you were one of the bell ringers.
So let me clarify.
All for the gram.
No. I committed to myself and I was talking to one of the other guys that I was going to finish this or I was going to die. I wasn't leaving. And I wasn't going to get medically rolled. I wasn't going to do any of that shit. I was going to stay until I graduated or I died. That was it.
And speaking of that, I don't know if you remember this. I remember this. We were doing something not even too difficult. It was like you were doing something on the ground. It was like a push-up or something. It was something so weird. Like one of the like really recovery
sitting.
Exercises we did. We had just been sitting and talking to you, right? And you stood up and your feet started stumbling. You started going backwards and falling like to the side. I'm like, oh my, this guy's fucking done. I don't know if you're low blood sugar, just your old age, whatever. I don't know what, I thought you were like having a heart attack or something.
Yeah.
And someone literally had to grab you and catch you because you were going down. You stood up and you were going down. And we come running over, the medics come running over and we're checking on you to see if you're all right. You're like, I'm just fucking fine. I'm just old. Sometimes it's hard to stand back up. I'm like, this old motherfucker. We thought you were like, that was funny as hell.
Yeah.
Like you were just stumbling in like a drunken sailor. But it was, you just said, I'm fine. I just, sometimes when I stand up, I get up too fast and I get a little vertigo. That was
I actually, I actually had a concussion day one. So we did the fighting with the pugil sticks and I went in the ring with Matt White, who is 6'4 and 250.
Yeah, it's not a mismatch at all.
Right, not at all. I'm 5'6 and 165, soaking wet. And he hit me. I went unconscious in the air, hit the ground, sat up, and then he sideswiped me again. And I heard you go, whoa, 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 don't kill him. And I sat there, pulled it together, and then went back out with Tyler, who was there, who was the next biggest guy. And you go, all right, who wants to take on Tyler? And I go, I'll do it. Barth, you almost fucking died the last time. What's wrong with you? I'm like, let's go. So I had vertigo the whole time. And that's why I lost the battle book, and because I'm old. And just couldn't find my place, but I was not leaving at all.
That's awesome. Because think about it. You know, when you're going out with your family, whatever, and you're at the grocery store, and right. someone decides to attack you, you don't get to choose the size of your attacker, the person that's attacking your family. You don't get to choose the size of them. So I don't know who would ever put you up against such big, young, fierce men, but that person's just an ass, I'm thinking. But so that was some of the moments for you. What were some of the other favorite moments of yours that you had a good time and that you just were happy to be there? And like, even in the suck, you're like, this is just a fucking privilege to be going through this tonight. What were some of your more favorite moments during the actual course itself?
When we had the picnic on the beach, and did I say that better?
Yeah.
Okay. So we had the picnic on the beach, and Ray is yelling at us and trying to see who could hold their breath the longest. I had the best time. The minute we walked into that surf, I was like, this is awesome. And I remember at the very end of it, they lined us all out, and I'm standing next to Ray, and I turn him and I go, that was fucking epic. Can we do that again? And he looks at me, he's like, the hell's wrong with you? All right. So we did that. And then the other one was the burial. The dash. I was looking forward to that because I knew, because I'd watched a video or a podcast you and Ray did, your Steve, with Bedros.
Thanks.
Yeah, just in case you forgot.
Old motherfucker.
So you had talked about doing that and then doing the avatars of your bitch, your beast, and your knight.
Right.
And I had to get to those. And so when we got to the burial, I was super jacked up because at the burial, it's all about what were you till then, and then who are you coming out? And so that was the best for me.
And at a time in your life, you were literally going through a rebirth, reborn, and a whole different chapter coming up, a whole different man, a whole different life, a whole different
person. It was a whole reset for me in there. I wanted to stay longer. I was pissed.
Because you're just sicker than you actually look. That's what it is. Sick man.
Yes, sir.
Sick man. So... So you graduated the project, obviously, and 5 months ago. What were some of the immediate impact that it had in your life? Like, you show up day one, this is already impacting you, like, right away. What were some of those things?
Self-confidence was back like that. The minute that Ray rang the bell and closed us out, I was like, wow, all right. Still a little hazy from what just happened, but self-confidence was back. My attention to detail has gotten way better. I promise I won't lose the book.
It had nowhere to go but up, but yeah, I hear you.
So you start at the ground, you can go up. Right. It was that. It was being able to understand how to section out my day, right? And you've been teaching me that since the project, as you got to have certain blocks of time. Here's where you do this. Here's where you do this. It's been amazing. And then having the brotherhood so that I can reach out to you. I can reach out to any of the classes. Doesn't matter that we've already gone through this together. So we are brothers bound by this experience, whether I've met you or not. And I could call any one of them and they could call me and we'd be able to help each other through things.
Just from your class or from?
All of them. My class, we were tight. But I got to know a few of the others from class one all the way through, and it's just been great. And then finally met them in Vegas. But knowing that I had a support system where I hadn't going into the project has been life-changing.
Other than, you're referring, I'm guessing, to your home support
system. Correct, right.
Did you have any type of circle of men around you that were also a support system, like-minded, that would help motivate you, lift you up? Did you have that type of...
I had
support
a few.
Around you?
Yeah, I had a few, but you guys have been talking about the inner circle and then the outer circle, and who you surround yourself with. The top five is who you become. Well, those that I were hanging around were not the top five; they were the bottom five. Mm-hmm. So I edited a lot of relationships leading up to, and then since, and so now the people I spend the most time with are the brothers.
The great thing about this show is you could talk shit about those bottom five and they'll never see this because they're such fucking losers that they won't even spend the time to watch something like this. So you don't have to worry about it. You can talk shit about whoever you want.
Perfect.
It works for me. Awesome. So that was some of the immediate effects. What about now? I mean, it's only 5 months down the line, but still, when people tell us all the time, oh, I can't spend $12,000 on just for a 4-day weekend course.
Right.
And that's what they see it as. I mean, did you even realize that there was an ongoing component to this whole thing? And did you realize that was like part of the program was going to be ongoing, this brotherhood that you're talking about?
I think, well, I heard it. You would say it, you and all the instructors would say it and say, this is a lifelong thing, but you don't, I mean, you're still going through it. So you're like, well, if I make it, I'll either be doing that or in my case, I'd have been dead. So it was like, whichever. But then once it ends, and it was amazing because you had all the cadres like myself, we were not saying anything to you, dead facing you the whole time. And then the minute that we rang out, they were coming up and saying, congratulations, glad you made it. You came up right away. You're like the second person that congratulated me. And right then you felt that brotherhood. And now it's amazing. And it's like, okay, you guys have to come back for the meetup in Vegas. And now you got to come back in cadre. And then you got to go do this. And it's unbelievable how much we are still connected. And even more so now that we're back here. It's great. I mean, it's never ending. And it's what you put in is what you'll get out. Mm-hmm. So if I want to be part of this, great. If I don't, I could go off and do whatever. But to really get the most out of it, you got to keep pouring in as much as you guys pour into us.
So immediately, pretty much, you had really a lifelong of lack of confidence, it sounded like, for, you know, since you were a kid, really, you said, you know, right then.
Yeah.
Building up to even personal relationships as an adult where it's not ideal or even semi, if you want to call it, abusive or something like that,
right,
mentally and you know, emotionally. And you were immediately able to just have a newfound confidence, like right away when you went home. Is that kind of where it was at?
Yeah, I mean, I had confidence before. I could walk the walk, but I would self-doubt a lot because of those other things. I still go through that at times. You know, they'll still come back and the bitch will kind of knock on your door. The inner bitch, it'll always come back.
It's everyone. Every one of us. Every one of us.
Well, except you, because you don't have a heart.
Fuck him.
So it still comes back at some point. But yeah, I felt much more grounded than I ever have in my life before.
Awesome. And going through this stuff you're going through personally in your personal life,
yeah,
how is having this brotherhood here now, this support system that you didn't have in any really area of life before, how's that kind of helped you through this transition phase? And, you know, you're still going through a transition phase.
It's been amazing. I mean, we did a high performance 12-week course, and you were in it with us, with one of the other brothers from, I think it was class four.
Four, yeah.
And
he was actually three.
He was in three, right. So I got to meet with all those guys, and then we would talk about what's happening, and you didn't know a lot of that stuff, and you texted me a couple times, like, I didn't know any of that. You need anything, you let me know, you know, and it's great to have that. And I've had conversations with quite a few other guys who have gone through it, or they're going through something else, and they're like, I heard this is happening with you. Where are you at? So you get people checking in on you all the time.
Some of them you probably never even met in your life, I'm guessing.
No, exactly. Some of them I've only met through the weekly check-ins that we do on our Facebook page or something like that, but I've never seen them face-to-face, but they always check in.
That's awesome. Pretty cool. That's a powerful and priceless thing to have at your disposal. So, you know, if you need to talk or you're feeling vulnerable and it's not being a little bitch to have a tough conversation or to feel vulnerable or feel like you're having a moment of weakness or something, but I know you have that support system of just kick-ass men that understand you and get you, and they're like-minded, and knowing that you share that bond of they've been through the same shit that you've been through. You know?
It's a gift. It's an absolute gift.
That's awesome. That's some deep, powerful stuff. So in addition to the brotherhood, what are some of the other effects that the project has just had on your life since then, these last few months, whether it's in your business, on the business side of things? You know, we've talked a lot about the personal side.
Yeah.
How about on the business side?
Business is coming along really well. I've been able to, as you've said, pull back from being in the business to being working on the business. So I've done a lot of work with that and still are doing. I mean, I still have a long way to go with it, but we're getting to a good pivotal point to where it's going to start turning the corner and being a big profitable business. So that's great.
In the fitness industry.
In the fitness industry, during all this, I mean, during COVID, there were 9 gyms that closed around me and I was still, and I'm still there. So that says a lot. And it came through right before everything shut down. Or no, it came after, but still, shortly we made after, it through. Yeah. See, there's the old man thing at me again.
Do you know where you are right now? You don't know what we're talking about, who I am?
You're Dave, right? So, it's the business is getting better because I feel better about myself, because I know I have people like you and people like Bedros and other brothers that can come in and say, hey, I've done this in the fitness industry, or this is what works for me and mine. Try it in yours. So you get inundated with information of things to try, and you try it and they work or they don't. But you've learned more stuff. So it's incredible.
So it's been a big part of your sustaining. I mean, even keeping your shit together. And I spoke to a couple of the graduates about the same thing, that it's hard enough in the fitness industry at any time, especially if, you know, down during this time when everything is just fucked and shut down and all that. So where would you see yourself now had you never have gone through the project, never had this brotherhood support system, both personally and then also professionally in the business? Where would you see yourself right now?
Not to sound too dramatic, but we'd have been out of business. We'd have been bankrupt. I'd probably still be going through a divorce, or I'd be a little lapdog for my ex. But I would not be where I am today without it. And I won't be where I will be in the next 3, 5, and 10 years without the brotherhood. Without a doubt.
That's some deep stuff. That's some powerful stuff right there. And, you know, on the professional side and the business side, to say
absolutely.
That, you know, people see the project and think it's just a challenge, a physical challenge, looks like something fun to do, maybe get a little motivation to get the spark back. Now, sure, it is all those things on a surface level, but to say that you would have been out of business and bankrupt and really essentially what you're saying is not have nutted up and you'd have been a lapdog is what you said. You'd
be like,
that's fucking crazy. That's some crazy shit.
Yeah. It's life changing. That's it. Life changing.
That is awesome stuff. So you're here to help out for this next class as a junior instructor. And I'm sure you're going to get just as much this time as you did going through the first time. And it's going to be, you're going to have so many more breakthroughs. It's going to be huge for your growth. I'm excited to see that for you. So again, I appreciate you coming
absolutely
to help with that. What's some advice you'd give to those gentlemen coming into this class or about to start this journey, you know, tomorrow? What's some advice you'd give for them in general in order to pass the project and then also just to pass the game of fucking life?
Yeah. So to pass the project, you just have to dig in. And one of the guys that I went through class 006 with said, when it gets rough, make your world 3 feet by 3 feet. Nothing else is around you. You know, and you just go until you or Ray or whoever says stop. And then even when you say stop, you just keep freaking going until you say, I said stop. So you never stop until it's told to be stopped. Just keep going because everything ends, but nobody thinks it does because you can't see past anything. Mm-hmm. So you got to just keep going. If you're here, you're here for a reason. And if you have already decided you're going to quit, then don't even show up. Because you're wasting time for those that want to get through this, for one. The other is be mentally prepared, because the physical piece, and you've always talked about this, but you don't know it till you're there. The physical piece is important, but it's secondary to the mindset. It's all about, can you have those conversations with your inner bitch throughout this? Can you get through that? And can you make it to the end?
Yeah, the physical part is going to be the hardest thing you've ever done in your life physically. And when it comes down to it,
nothing.
That's the easy part.
Yeah.
That is the easy part. It's the mental, emotional, social, spiritual.
Right.
100%.
And give yourself completely. So take the information, because it's not personal. It is personal. It's very personal. But
oh, it's personal. I love the sound of that bell ringing. It's like music to my,
yes, you do.
That's my number one favorite soundtrack right behind. It's a close one. That and
that other thing we were talking about.
And the bombs and the machine gun fire that Ed created. Those two are like, I play them all the time. When I can't sleep, I'll put on a bell ringing, or I'll put on the fire bombs and the goats and whatever else is in that music.
That is sick and demented. I can't listen to that. I still have haunted dreams, but you have to get through it. You have to just dig in and do whatever it takes, because you'll be a better man for your family, for your business, for you, for whatever you believe in, the goats, whatever the case may be. If you don't complete this, I can't even think about what those guys that went through and quit. And we had two guys in our class that rang out. One guy made it, the other guy got med rolled. And the guy that quit before and then graduated with us, he said it was the worst year of his life. Mm-hmm. I couldn't imagine that.
You had a guy who quit. He came a year and a half later,
yep,
came back to redeem himself.
Yeah, he did.
The second one ever to come back through the program and actually graduate that had quit. They all say they're going to come back. They all say they're going to do
it. But he was a beast. He didn't give up.
Yeah, that was awesome. So again, thanks for coming and joining us on the show. Chris Barth, graduate of class 006. If you've gotten anything out of this program, which I'm sure you have, Chris is dropping some knowledge bombs for you and some real just his ancient wisdom. He went to high school with fucking Moses. His phone number is 7. That's how old this guy is. So he's got some wisdom that we can all learn from. And I always go back and rewatch these recordings. I take notes myself. I would sit here with a notebook if I could here on camera. So if you've gotten anything out of this video, just like it, share it. Leave a comment down below. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. And if you need help with killing that inner bitch, or at least learning how to temporarily shut it up and have the skill set, the mindset, and the tools to overcome that inner bitch on a daily basis so you can become an even better husband, father, entrepreneur, leader, and man, let's talk about it, whether or not you're a good fit for the project. We'll jump on the phone for an interview and see if you have what it takes to join the MDK Brotherhood. This has been another episode of the MDK Modern Day Night Project Show. I will talk to you next time. You are fucking awesome. No excuses.